Welcome everyone to the Inside Java Newscast, where we cover recent developments in the OpenJDK community. I'm Nikolai Parlock, Java developer advocate at Oracle, and today we're going to look into scoped values, a convenient, safe, and scalable way to manage ThreadLocal data. Ready? Then let's dive right in. All non-trivial methods have data as input. Most commonly, these are method arguments or instance fields, but there are exceptions where a method draws from static fields, from its own class, or even from another class.
Really? No one else gasped?
Yes. Such package local or even global state is a huge red flag, but you know how it is. You can't make an omelette without red flags. I feel like the metaphor's got away from me here. Anyways, sometimes a method needs data that, for some reason or another, can't be passed as an argument or consigned to an instance field. You may be writing a framework where control passes from your code to user code and back to you, but you don't want to burden users with passing along arguments that are useless to them or have security implications. Or maybe you're using something that isn't thread-safe, but highly mutable, like a graphics context. Or maybe you need to keep track of thread-specific context information, for example, a request ID for logging, or transaction ID to flatten nested transactions. None of these use cases are terribly common in our code, which is why we don't often do this, but it's also not unheard of, which is why Java has a solution for this. Now too, actually. Let's discuss the new one first, and then I'll contrast it with the old solution and explain why a new one was needed. JDK 24 previews scope values for a fourth time. Let me quote from JEP 487. A scoped value is a container object that allows the data value to be safely and efficiently shared by a method with its direct and indirect callees within the same thread and with child threads without resorting to method parameters. It is a variable of type scope value, and it's typically declared as a static final field, and its accessibility is set to private so that it cannot be directly accessed by code in another class. On that last one, I want to add that private should be your default, but package or even global visibility isn't unheard of.
Oh, come on, that was gasp-worthy. There's something wrong with you people.
Okay, so what do you do with a scope value except declaring it? In order to use it, you have to bind it to some data and then pass a lambda that will be immediately executed. The lambda and all code called from it will be able to access the data by calling get, but once it ran its course, the data will be cleaned up and no other code can access it. That means the data, the value, is only accessible within the scope of the lambda, hence the name scope value, which makes the code easy to reason about. Leaning further into ease of use, scope values also prohibit setting new data. So the called code cannot set something that the calling code can later read. Data transmission is one way from caller to callee. That said, code can rebind the scope values for its callees. This may sound confusing, but it's actually pretty straightforward. Just think of it as nested scopes. Method A binds 42 and then calls method B. B can get 42 from the scope value, rebind it to, say, 43, and then call method C. When C calls get, it reads 43. No way to see 42, and also no way to write anything to the scope value that the outer scope that B can observe. When control flow eventually returns from C to B, it in turn only sees 42. When execution splits into multiple threads, scopes can get easily lost. If 42 was bound for the execution of method X, which kicks off method Y in a separate thread and then finishes its own execution, should 42 be unbound? Hard to say when we don't know whether Y is still busy and might try to read the value later. So by default, scope values provide thread isolation, and calling get from a different thread than the one that bound the value won't work. But there's an exception to the scoping issue, and that's the structure concurrency API. It also hinges on scopes, namely that when a task splits into concurrent subtasks / threads, their completion is awaited and their results are collected in the same scope while the parent thread waits. Or in other words, the child's thread scopes are entirely contained in the parent thread scope. And that's perfect. It means that all scope values the parent thread has access to can be inherited to the child threads, and indeed that's exactly how scope values and the structure concurrency API interoperate. So, TLDR, in general, data in a scope value is only accessible from the thread which bound it. But if the structure concurrency API is used, the data is automatically inherited to the threads it forks. If you have ever used thread locals, much of this will seem familiar to you. They too allow transmitting data without passing arguments, and they too provide thread isolation. In fact, at first glance, their use seems very similar. First, create a thread local variable that is usually private, static, and final, then set data, execute code that can get that data, and make use of the fact that data is isolated per thread. Beyond these similarities, there are a number of crucial differences, though. First, all code with access to the ThreadLocal can both read and write data, which allows for complex data flows between callers and callees. To keep code readable, that's best avoided though, and indeed, this isn't frequently used. Yet when reading ThreadLocal code, you can never be sure and need to check carefully. Scope values make this much easier as there's no question to whether data flows both ways. No, it can't. Second, my earlier explanation of ThreadLocal's API flow left out an essential step, removing the data when it is no longer needed. In fact, developers using this API also occasionally forget it, which can lead to performance and security issues, as data can then be visible to entirely unrelated code that just happens to run the same thread. And we're not forgetting removal, sufficiently complex use of ThreadLocal's API can just make it really hard to get right. None of this is an issue with scope values, as the clearly defined scope allows the API to automatically remove the data when it's no longer needed. And third and last, as the name suggests, ThreadLocals isolate data by thread. But if you want to, you can also use them to pass data from one thread to another by using an instance of inheritable ThreadLocal instead. Then, if one thread launches another, the ThreadLocal variable is copied and the new thread starts by using the same data. But if a thread launches a lot of threads like this, these copies pile up and can consume a sizable amount of memory. Scope values one-way data transmission makes copy unnecessary, so they scale really well with lots and lots of threads. And it was mainly that last point that triggered the development of the scope values API, because virtual threads allow orders of magnitude more threads, and so ThreadLocal's memory issue becomes more pressing. But note that virtual threads and ThreadLocals do work together correctly, so it's not like you need to refactor from ThreadLocals to scope values. You may want to for readability though. In fact, scope values should be a default for this kind of use case. Only use ThreadLocal for the dirty cases, when you really need two-way data transmission or unscoped lifetime for your global state.
Oh, great gasp, everyone. Bravo.
The structured concurrency and scope value APIs are both in their fourth preview in JDK 24. Structured concurrency will probably see a slight revamp and another preview in 25, but scope values seem to be stable and they may finalize. We find out more about that once Java 24 gets released in 2.5 weeks at Java 1, something we'll live stream on this channel, by the way, link to more details in the description. Following that, OpenJDK will turn towards 25, and I expect new JEPs to be filed soon after. As always, you learn all about that here, so subscribe if you haven't already, and leave a like to help us spread the word. So long!